Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for attending this presentation, where I will speak about my journey in PostgreSQL bug fixing. So first of all, just a few words about me. So I am doing databases since about 25 years. I used to do a lot of Oracle, but it's over because now I fell in love with Postgres. And so that's why I am now working at AWS in the RDS Postgres contributor teams, where our role is mainly to contribute to upstream Postgres. Could be a bug fix or new features. This is my Twitter handle and my blog. So before starting with the agenda, just a few questions. How many of you already hit a bug in Postgres? How many of you did report this bug to the community? How many of you did report a repro with the bug? Okay. And how many of you did attach a patch or a proposed patch with the bug? Okay, cool. Thank you. So, yeah, I think that this presentation can make sense. So, about the agenda. So, first of all, I will tell you what this presentation is not about. I mean, I will not be exhaustive because it will be too much. And then I will tell you what is this presentation is about. What I think, what I do when I discover a bug, and some example with a live demo or how I reported a bug and produced a patch and this kind of stuff. So, what is presentation not about? So, a lot of things, but among those stuff, a complete guide on how to report a bug. Yeah, that's not the purpose of it. A complete guide on how to fix a bug. Yeah, I'm not sure it's possible to write such a guide anyway, so that is not this. So, what is it about? Is just sharing my own experience with a live demo and show you how we can do this kind of stuff. I am not saying it has to be done that way, just how I did it in the past and how I do it. So, a bug is discovered. So, I can understand that you have a very bad feeling. Oops, sorry. Because it already. It all depends on the context. I mean, if it is a Sunday morning on a production database, yes, I can understand you are upset. But on the other hand, sometimes there is good opportunity as well. If you discover this bug on dev environment while you are working on something new or whatever, so that's a good opportunity to learn something, to deep dive on something, and to report to the community. And reporting a bug to the community is kind of welcome because, I mean, everybody agreed that this bug has to be fixed anyway. It's not like you're proposing a new features that maybe nobody cares. So with a bug, that's not the case. So that's a good opportunity to interact with the community. So first of all, what I do, I try to have a repro, means something that I launch every time produce the bug. If I am not working on the most recent version, I try to check if this bug is fixed in most recent version. I try to write a patch and I report the bug. So this is how it should be done. I mean, there is this link that describes how to report a bug. So we will see three examples, sorted by level of difficulty. So for the first one, there is no C coding needed at all. You can report a bug sometimes without doing any C coding. The other one is we don't need to build a repo, we already have it, but we will try to build a patch. And the last one, we have nothing in N except the error. And a function that is so a symptom of the bug that is producing the error. So we will start from there, trying to build a repro, a patch, and yeah. that's it. So this is coming from real life, from stuff that I did. None of the patch that I submitted is the one that get committed at the end, but at the end, all of the bugs have been fixed, which I think is the main goal, and I learned also a lot during this journey, so I hope it will be the same for you. So I think now it's time for live demo. Let's go. Oops, can you see the screen even in the back? Yes. Okay. So for example, no C coding is needed. So here I am creating a certain environment. Okay. I start the instance. I connect to it, and I will launch this stuff, which is creating a trigger on and dropping a colon and updating to trigger the trigger. It's not very important. What is important is that if you do that, so if you launch this stuff, it crashed. Okay, so it arrives on 13 on the last minor. But at that time, 14 last minor was already there. So let's check if it is fixed on 14. Who knows? So stop this. Starting a 14 environment, last minor. Okay. I launch the stuff. It works. So we could already go to the community and say, I have this stuff that is failing on the last minor of 13, but it and is working on the last minor on 14, but which will be already good, but we can do better than that. We can provide the commit in the source tree that fix this issue. Okay? Because something fixed this issue somewhere. So. So to do that, I go in the Postgres source tree, and I will be using git bisect. So if I run this, so it's looking for a good and a bad commit. So normally this stuff is used to find out the commit that produce an issue. Okay? So it means the good commit has to be the oldest one. In our case, that's the opposite. We want to find the commit that fix the issue. So in your mind, and even here, we will just invert both worlds. So we will say it's a good commit when it crashed, and it's a bad commit when it works. Okay? So this is the Git log, for example. And so you did some research and you find a good and a bad commit. Okay, so this is a good commit, mean it crashed. And this is a bad commit, means it works. Okay, and then git bisect automatically switch to a new commit on the source tree. Then let's compile Postgres with this source. Okay. Let's initialize a new instance. Start it and try. Also, it crashed. Okay. So with this commit in place, it crashed. So now we have to tell to git bisect that for us it is a good commit. Boom. And doing so, it switched to another commit. So let's do it again. So compile. Initialize l'instance. start, launch our stuff. It works. So now we can say to git bisect that this is a bad commit. Okay. So it switched to this one, 20D3, something like this, I think. So compile, initialize, start the instance, connect, launch our stuff. It works. So we will say to git bisect that this is a bad commit for us. Boom, it's over. So he's saying this commit is the one that fixed the issue. So now we can go back to the community and say, I have this that is failing on 13 last minor, this that is working on 14 last minor. This commit is the one that fixed the issue so that you find it. And that's more details to the community. And there is nothing more we can do. And we can say, please backpatch if you agree this fix to back to 13, for example. And just checking what has been done. So this is the commit that backpatched the other commit. So this is Tom that backpatched this stuff, and then he clearly mentioned the commit here that we just discovered together a couple of minutes ago. So I think that's a good example. It's pretty rare, but that's a good example of being able to provide a bug and with the fix already in hand because it's already in the source tree. And no second needed. Okay, so now let's go to the second example. Or maybe you have a question? Sorry. No. Okay, so let's go to the second example. So this one, we already have a repro, and we will try to create a patch. So let's create another environment. Start it. So here I will create a table. Very simple. So just one primary key. Okay. I will insert two rows, one with value 1, one with value 2. I create another table. I insert a row in it. And then I will launch a PLSQL, PL block, this one. So for in 1, 2, begin, I insert into this the table that has the primary key. So the primary key constraint will be violated. So I just put an exception in it, and I say then I update the other table. Commit, and loop. And execute, boom, crash. So again, it's a real life story. So it was on my dev environment. I was doing some stuff. And on my dev environment, I always compile Postgres with assertion enabled. And by luck, this one triggered an exception that makes this crash. So I just grep assert in the log file. So the assertion is this one, portal snapshot is null, which is not the case. So the assertion is saying, hey, your portal snapshot is not null. And we have the file, name and the line. So just open it. Oops. So the issue appear in this function here. Ensure snapshot exists. So the assertion that is here is failing. So we don't have a null snapshot, okay? And important stuff to note is here, we could exit the function before, okay? So we will take care of this as well. We will check what is in this. Some line numbers, but we already know that. the line number, and okay. So what can we do with that? So I create a session. I take my backend PID, and I will attach a debugger in it, on the session. So I copy the backend PID here. Boom. Push. Here we go. So the problem is on the portal snapshot. So there is a function that creates the portal. I will set a breakpoint on it because I want to follow the portal snapshot, and I will show you how. Here, this is another breakpoint when we will reach the function that has the failing assert. So this be like the breakpoint. Here, this is another breakpoint, but just to show you the query that will be running at that time. It's easier to understand. And here, this is our failing assertion. Let's go. So relaunch the PL block that is failing. Put. Okay, so we are in create portal. So just let's go at the end of it when it will return the portal. So he's setting some stuff. Okay, so here it will return the portal. So I want to see the portal snapshot right now. So this is the portal. So the snapshot is null. It will move from null to non-null and all this stuff. I want to follow that. I want to see where it happens. So to do that, I will set a watch point on it. So before that, I will just create a breakpoint. It's not necessary right now, but I will create a breakpoint on the failing function. And so I will set a watch point on the portal snapshot, on this address, to see where its contents is changing. And then I will relaunch the stuff. I will continue. So here we can see that our watch point triggered. Portal snapshot is passing from null to non-null. Okay? So out of curiosity, just check where it happens. So this is a backtrace. So it happens here in exact simple query, for example. Okay. Let's continue. So here we are inside the failing function. So here we are checking if active snapshot set. So this stuff is doing nothing but checking that active snapshot is not null, which is the case here. And again, as this stuff has an impact on the assertion, to reach the assertion point, I want to follow when this stuff is changing value. So I will put a watch point on it and continue. So here I am again here. It's not null, so we return. So now we are here because I want to show you what we are being executing now. So now we are executing this insert into values E. So that's the first time that we see it. So it means we are inserting with value 1. Let's continue. So we will enter the problematic function. We did not see the active snapshot being changed. So it means it's still not null. It means that we will exit the function. So here, this is one place where it's changing its value. Just out of curiosity, this one, okay, and then continue. So here we are aborting the sub-transaction, so it's changing from non-null to not-null, so for the moment it's good. And now we are executing the update, so we aborted the sub-transaction and we are executing the update. Let's continue. So we will enter the problematic function again. Here is still not null, so means we will exit the function. Here, the active snapshot is not from not null to not null, which is good for us. Just out of curiosity here, okay. Still not null from not null. Continue. Okay, boom. Here now, we are here. And we are setting the portal snapshot from a non-null value to a null value, which is good for the moment because this is what our assertion is waiting for. So just let's continue. So here we are changing the active snapshot from not null to null. It's null. So now we are both snapshot the portal snapshot which is null and the active snapshot which is null. So and now we are going to execute the other insert, the second insert, so with value 2. So far so good. The exception has not been reached. Let's continue. So here we are going from null to non-null, which is good, and here from non-null to null. Okay, let's continue. So we enter the exec snap function. And yeah, now we have a null value here. So we did not exit this function. So we are slowly reaching the assertion or going close to him. So let's go. But for the moment, we still have a portal snapshot that is null. So that's good. We are not reaching, I mean, the assertion is okay. So we can continue. So now the portal snapshot is changing. No, sorry, the active snapshot is from null to non-null. And the portal snapshot is now getting a value, which could trigger a bad assertion right now. Continue. But it cannot, because for the moment, we still have the active snapshot, which is not null. Let's continue. Still not null. Here. Oh, now we have our active snapshot that is null. Means now we are exactly in the condition that will produce the error because we have portal snapshot not null and this one that is null. So it, as you can see, it happens in this function, which is aborting the sub-transaction. Let's continue. Okay, so now we will execute the last update. So yeah, active snapshot not null, null to null to not null, and then not null to null. So we will enter the problematic function, and now here we have a null active snapshot. Boom, means we don't exit the function. And then now we are in this assertion with a portal snapshot which is not null. Okay, and then we are reaching the failed assertion. Means if I quit, oops, yes, it crashed. So we have seen more or less when it happens. So the issue happens during the last update and it's somehow linked to aborting a sub-transaction. My understanding at that time of the portal stuff was very small or maybe inexistent. But what I try to do is to create a patch and just a very basic one. I knew it was not the patch that will fix the issue, but I tried something new. As you can see, it's pretty stupid. It's just saying in the function that we have seen multiple times, if I have an active portal when the active snapshot is null, then I put this portal snapshot to null. So with this patch in place, let's compile. Start. Relance le bloc. Touch. It works. So with this stupid patch, it works. So I reach out to the community with this patch, saying, I'm sure it's not the right patch, but this is what I observe, this is the repro, and this is what I'm trying to do. And then, so I think, yeah, it's again Tom that intervene, and that you see here, report and patch by Bertrando, which keeps using by me, so it means that he explained me how to fix this stuff, because obviously the first patch was not the right one. And yeah, so he kind of guided me to how to fix that. And with the understanding from the GDB that I did, I more or less understood what he guided me to. And so I think that's a good example to learn. Even if you are not sure of your patch, or maybe even if you don't have one, just go back and you will receive maybe the help like I did. So yes, it's much more complicated to what I did here. We need to track of the sub nested level of the sub transaction. Okay, so that was the second case. So the main outcome of this one is don't be afraid to submit a patch even if you think that it's not the right one, but say it during your reach out, and that's what I did. And at the end, you will learn something. So the third one, let's create an environment. So less GDB in this one. So logical decoding in place. I want to get some change. Boom. Okay, nice. So what I do when I have this kind of stuff, so I just grab for the error in the code. I mean, why not? Oops, here we are lucky. We just have one occurrence of this error in the C code. So let's open the file. When we find this, let's search for the error. We don't see it here. Okay. So the error is where? Here. So it's checking for a real OID. If it is a valid OID, then we report this error. And we don't see it here, but the real OID is coming from a function that the return value of a function that I will show you after. So we are having this issue here. And the line number is this one. Okay. So this is the function, this is the function that will give us the bad rel ID, let's say. Okay. Okay. So now that you have that, again, create a new session. Attach a GDB function, debugger function on it. Good. So I want to set a breakpoint where the issue is, and also I want to put a breakpoint on the function that return the invalid OID. This is it. Let's resume working and launch this stuff. So we enter the function that will return the bad OID, the invalid OID. So let's advance a bit. Okay, so here we set rel ID to invalid OID and we hope that this will change. And is looking for this rel ID in relation ID, which is PG class, in fact. So it opens PG class and is looking for the red file node this one here, in PG class. So the red file number is this one. Okay. and then he move on, and then he return a valid UID. So just look at which transaction was being logically decoded, if I can say. So it is this transaction number. So it's 740. Okay, just keep that in mind and quit. So let's do the same. I mean, just check ourselves if this rel-find number exists in PG class, yes or no. Yes, it exists. So, and it exists with a xmin that is lower than the xmin that the xid that we were logical decoding. So if I see it and the logical decoding say this is does not see it, it means that for the logical decoding stuff, function here, no, not this function, this xid here has not committed. If not, you will see it. So let's look at what the XID that we were decoding. So we were decoding this, which is nothing but doing an insert in this rel-find node. So the problematic one, and then commit, nothing more. And then when we are seeing this, keep in mind that we want to build a repro. So the failing stuff is just doing an insert. Let's see who manipulated this rel-find node. So it has been manipulated by this commit, but we already knew it. Okay. So what's that? So this XID is in fact a sub transaction of this one. So let's see what this one was doing. So this one was doing nothing but creating the sub transaction and committing. So again, keep this in mind. So we suspect that we have a visibility issue. So building the MVCC snapshot for logical decoding, because we don't see the entry in PG class while it's there. So something is wrong when creating the MVCC snapshot. So this is the file to open. This is where it happens. So here we are seeing that we need to access catalog tables when doing logical decoding, and that's the only thing that matters to us. And in fact, this is what we are doing because we are opening PG class. We are also seeing that we cannot rely on the standard stuff to see if it is committed or not. And we are seeing that between xmin and xmax, in the MVCC, normally, I mean, outside of logical decoding, you have the ongoing transaction, right? But here, we are seeing that between those two values, we are seeing the committed transaction that modified the catalog. Okay, so something is wrong in this area. So this is the function that creates the snapshot at commit time. Here we can see that we have a function that check if you have a catalog modifying transaction, which matters to us for PG class. And you have this friend here to set. And there is one important function, which is this one, which is to process the new CID, which means if you look at here we only log new CID if catalog tuple was modified, so mark the transaction as containing catalog modification. So this function is very important and is based on new CID. What is new CID? Oops. It's there. So this function is called here when we are replaying, not replaying, where When we are logical decoding the heap new CID old record. Yeah, so we have those old records here for the transaction that committed the modification in PG class. So they are there and there. So normally, this should tell the logical decoding that this transaction modified the catalog. So why it is not the case? Let's check from where we start to logical decoding. So we start from this restart LSN. Okay. Okay, so here I am checking everything that is under this restart, after this restart LSN. And as you can see, we don't see the new CID stuff. So it means if we restart from there, there is no clue to know that the new CID happened because we will not read the whole file for that. And it's there, but it means that the new CID here. So the LSN for this new CID is before the restart LSN of the logical decoding. Then there is no way for the logical decoding in this state to know that this is a modifying catalog transaction. Let's look at the sequence of event in the whole file. Yeah, so you have the new CID here and here the restart LSN. So that's the issue, that's the visibility issue. The CID are not decoded, so there is no way it knows that. Just to be sure, we check this XID from this restart LSN, there is nothing. So that's the issue. So now reattach the debugger. Okay, so breakpoint on the issue. Breakpoint on this function to see if we are going through it, but normally we should not because we don't read the CID. So, and relaunch this stuff. So we are going to emit the error. So now I want to see the MVCC snapshot that the logical decoding used. Remember that everything that is committed is between xmin and xmax. So the xmin is this one, the xmax is this one. So the transaction 739 is not there, which is the subtransaction of it. So it's not considered as committed in the MVCC snapshot for the logical decoding. And so we have the error. So there is a trick to make it happen in live. So just put a breakpoint here. Here, that is our problematic function, okay? And relaunch the stuff. So we are in this function that is building the MVCC snapshot for the logical decoding. Okay, next. And so the XID is this one. The subtransactions are there because it correctly reads the whole record for that. And the trick to say this is a committed transaction here for the catalog, you can put that. We have seen that in the other function at the beginning. So here I am, thanks to the debugger, I am modifying on the fly this value. And then I continue. Okay. And then we are now in the problematic function. So we are decoding the XID that will produce normally the issue. Let's look at the MVCC snapshot. So we start from this value, but now the XMAX is this one. So everything that is between those values are committed XID. And we find our catalog change XID now, which means that now if I continue, I can decode. So I don't see the error anymore. Okay, so that's it. That's the reason why. Yeah, and we can see that the last commit has an invalidation message, and we will use this later. So I'm just stopping now the instance. I restart it. And now it's time to build our repo. I mean, we already know what happens. We have a transaction that created a sub-transaction. This sub-transaction created truncated the re relation, then providing new CID. And then after that, we have another transaction that inserted into this relation. Okay, so I just create a logical replication slot, and I will build a repro. So I create a table. Oops. Here, I am just running a logical decoding stuff to make the logical for the slot advance. And here, I want to check this value. Okay. So I begin. So this is the now the sub-transaction. The sub-transaction does a truncate. Boom. Nothing more. And here, now I will do checkpoint and I will wait for the conf. I don't see the confirm flush send to change. So it changed. Means now I can commit. Okay. And so this is the first part. The second part is just the insert. So it was the failing one, right? So begin, insert. And here again, checkpoint. And check that the value change. Am waiting for those values to change because I want to restart the descent from this point. Maybe it has changed already. I don't see well, in fact. Did you see something changing here? No? Okay. So probably it's already changed. So let's stop it. And so now if I try to logical decode from this new replication slot, I have the issue. So this is our repro. Okay. So we have the repro, we can try to build a patch, which was this one. So basically, when we read from the restarted SN, if we find the commit, which is the 738 in our case, that has a validation message in it, we are saying that all the transactions that we see in this commit are catalog modifying transactions. So we don't rely on the CID stuff anymore with this patch. So just build this with the patch. Start. And now if I try to logical decode with the patch, boom, it works. And it works. So this is the patch that has been proposed. And our has it been fixed? So it has been fixed here. So on the master branch, something different has been done. They change the serialize the logical snapshot that is on disk to be able to store the catalog modifying transaction. But for the other branch, for the back patch, we cannot change for the this. So what we propose has more or less been implemented. And I think that's it. Thank
you. Okay, it looks like there's some time for questions.
Yeah.
So if there's any, go ahead and ask.
I was a little bit late. Maybe you answered that already in the beginning, but how do you find these bugs in the first place?
So could be from customer. I mean, at AWS, the fleet is so big that we see a lot of bugs. Okay, and could be also with playing with myself.
Well, it doesn't look like there's any more questions. If there's any, oh.
Hello, not really related to directly related to your presentation, but what do you use to record your terminal session and turn it into a presentation? That's cool, actually.
Yeah, thank you. In fact, it's not recorded. It was in Direct Live. Yeah. So I have a Temux session here that you can see. And then on my laptop here, I have a VI on
and you inject, okay.
All the Temux command that I inject here.
Okay.
And in VIRC, I have a script that translates a click to find Temux and execute.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.